Well, good afternoon, everybody. And for those who don't know me, I'm Melanie Leach. I'm Chief Executive of the BPF. And in a moment, I'm going to introduce one by one each of the stellar panel that we have in front of us this afternoon to debate some of the key issues around building back better and the role of real estate in that. And there are two real challenges, I think, that we'll bring out during the course of that discussion. And one is around the levelling up agenda that the government set itself and how important real estate is to that agenda to level up across the country, to regenerate, revitalise, re-energise our town centres, particularly as we build back from the COVID pandemic. And secondly, the challenge to hit our legally binding targets and how we're going to do that. So it's clear that we are a fundamental part of making sure that we do hit those targets. But to do that, what do we need? We need a clear regulatory and policy framework. We need innovation. We need commitment from across the industry. And we'll unpack some of that and talk about how we're going to get there and play our part in all of that over the next hour or so. We want this session to be interactive. We don't want just to talk amongst ourselves. We'd really love to hear from you. We'd love to hear your views. We'd love to hear your questions. Please don't miss the opportunity to engage with our panel and to get a real conversation going. I know my panel is never short of things to say, and I'm sure they're going to say some things that will provoke some thought and some interest. So please do get involved. Use the Q&A function to do that, and I will bring in as many questions as I can in the course of the next hour. So with that introduction and without further ado, I'm going to turn first to Peter Freeman, will be known to many, I suspect, on the webinar. The badge we've given you today, Peter, is Chair of Homes England, but you've been many, many things over the course of a long career in property. So over to you first, if I may.
Thank you, Melanie. Much of the agenda today is about urbanism, and I began my urbanist career 60 years ago when I was five, because I walked to school down a busy high street to the local school. And I then sort of skipped about 40 years until I bought Brindley Place with the help of my good friend Rob Bold. And then I really began to understand about mixed use, the walkable neighbourhood and placemaking. So whether I'm in a Homes England hat or an Argent hat, I'd like to think of myself as a placemaker first and foremost.
Thank you, Peter. And Peter, I'll stick with you and I think ask you a question before I bring the others in. So I'll introduce people and bring them in with a question as I do that. So from all of that experience and from bringing that experience to your current role at Homes England, how do you see the challenges around building thriving urban centres, placemaking, and what role do you see Homes England playing in that?
I'll answer what role the government maybe has to play in it. And if they're kind enough to give that role to Homes England, we'd be delighted to do it. I think we have, maybe 10 core cities still, which have largely recovered in the sort of urban renaissance that Lord Rogers set out probably 30 years ago, places like Birmingham and Manchester and Liverpool, Merseyside. But we've got 200 cities that are probably to some extent or another floundering. And I think that to get international investment, national investment into them, to turn them around on a comprehensive scale, they need town plans. So that's local authorities need more support in terms of both leadership and mentoring and the finance for the studies. But I think beyond that also, there needs to be an aggregation of investment funds. And I think government can help achieve that to get the funds into towns, which investors wouldn't go to individually. But if you can diversify the risk across many towns, many buildings, many uses, I think investors will go back to those towns.
Thank you, Peter. We'll turn next to Jackie Saddock. Again, I think, Jackie, you've played many roles in a long and distinguished career in property, but your badge for today is the Chief Operating Officer of UK Regeneration. And I think, I'm sure, in introducing yourself a little bit more to our audience, you'll know more about that, very ambitious new village centre development and the values that are at the core of that development. So how do you marry those values and those ideals with the cold, hard reality of getting the job done and making a profit out of it?
Well, thank you, Melanie. I think you're really saying that I'm a very old woman, which is true. And I've been around the track more than once. And I've held positions in the private sector, in the property industry, and I've held positions in the public sector. And I guess my big thing, my big shtick, is the occupying the interstitial spaces between the two, the public sector and the private sector, where there is a rich, fertile ground, in my view, for real sensitive development, working with communities. So you very kindly allude to the garden community we're trying to bring forward in East Bedfordshire, and none of this stuff is easy at all. But one of the things that I had to do early doors was basically assure the existing residents, the existing town that we have appended ourselves to, that we would put their needs, their objectives, their values first. And that has won us a position of trust. We are bringing forward 1,500 homes in East Bedfordshire against a market town called Biggleswade. We are looking to retrospectively integrate those homes with the existing market town. We are not looking to do any retail. We're looking to force all the trade into the existing town centre and to help the town council to regenerate the town centre in so doing. So, yeah, I mean, it's not easy. It's been particularly tough during the pandemic, but it is my life work. And I think we have developed now a model in UKR whereby we are both investors in any place, and in this case, a slightly tired market town that needs some support, but also partners. And that, I think, is very important to the ethos.
Thanks, Jackie. And we'll come back to that theme of partnership, I'm pretty sure, over the next 45 minutes or so. Rob Bold, I'm now going to be accused of telling you you're very old as well, if I refer to the fact that you also have had a long and distinguished career in the property sector. And I think it's fair to say you've probably seen a lot of change over that time. You know, not everything is cyclical. I think, you know, there is a sort of underlying innovative and forward moving trend as well. So how has that change evolved, you know, perhaps from, you know, in recent times in particular? What do you hear from the people you work with, from, you know, your travels around the place, that give you confidence that investment, you know, will come into UK real estate to tackle some of the challenges that we're touching on in the seminar?
Thank you, Melanie. Actually, picking up a few comments just in this few introductory words that Peter and Jackie made, which are always illuminating when I listen to them. But they use the word trust, and they use the word partnership, and they didn't use the word transparency, but I'd like to come back to that. So I'm here today because for about 40 years, I was CEO of a business called GVA that became Avis & Young, very, very actively involved in the planning environment. We had a big planning practice. And all the way through that career path, and as one of the original founding members of the Investment Property Forum, I've had a fascination in respect of fractionalization, securitization of real estate, and effectively looking at how you could attract a wider universe of investor into the real estate market. Because to be fair, as the two previous speakers have said, it's been a bit of a club. Well, COVID or not, we have now arrived at a particular place in real estate. It's a very exciting place in real estate. I'm really looking forward to the discussion a bit later with Peter about government's involvement and the private sector, because I don't think that is the solution. I think there has got to be a partnership and a way to deal with it. My representation today is as a senior advisor of IPSX, which is Stock Exchange, which is regulated by the FCA. And also, I'm not going to miss an opportunity to promote Land Aid as chair of Land Aid, because I'm very interested in what Sarah Foster has to say in respect of social impact and value. More later.
Thank you, Rob. And as a trustee of Land Aid, how could I deny you that opportunity? Adrian, turning to you next, head of Real Asset Solutions at Fidelity International. And I know that, you know, the words that Rob and others have used around trust, transparency, and so indeed social impact will very much have resonated with you. So tell me a little bit about what that's meant for you at Fidelity and what the journey ahead looks like on that front.
Sure. Thanks very much, Melanie. So I guess I'm the young pup in this illustrious panel, since I've only been involved in real estate, or if I include my university years, then I can just about get to three decades, since I will cite that civil engineering is still a core part of what we do. So that was my introduction into the real estate world. But then since then, it's very much been on the advisory side, both in terms of listed companies and unlisted. And then now more latterly working within Fidelity, actually, and building out on behalf of our investors, a real estate portfolio, very much from investment purposes. And so really the perspective, I guess, I'm hoping to share with our audience is actually bringing much more the international perspective, because absolutely the UK has been at the forefront of a number of things, but at times we can't be at front of absolutely everything. And I think one of those is actually ESG. We are somewhat coming from behind, but and sometimes actually it's good to be coming from behind, because you don't necessarily have to make some of the mistakes of others. You can learn from other people's mistakes. And really the view that I have, and certainly influences a lot of the thinking that we've got at Fidelity, is actually for the last 40 odd years, investors have had really one sole purpose, which is to basically extract and maximize shareholder returns. And shareholder returns was very much defined as financial performance. Investors now are increasingly challenging that notion themselves and saying, actually, we want you to be measuring a number of other different outcomes, one of which is ESG. And that's clearly the most advanced one, but there are increasingly more. And really, for me, it's very much about how we can remain relevant, both for our investors, but ultimately for the end users of what we deliver, which is that social infrastructure, whether that's in buildings, whether that's in the environment that we talk about, or indeed the social setting, which other members of the panels have been spending many decades doing. I'm not going to try and suggest that I know anything more than that. Really, what we're trying to do is actually, can we deliver a capital that is cost-effective for those who need it and meet their requirements, not just to be able to deliver financial performance for their investors, but actually deliver the social performance for those who go on to use that space, those buildings and so forth.
Thank you, Adrian. And last but by no means least, Sarah Forster, CEO and co-founder of The Good Economy. And Sarah, I know that you've been doing a lot of work on the social impact of real estate in the real environment with the ULI and the Pensions for Purpose and the Impact Investing Institute. So what kind of future do you see for real estate investors to play a greater role in delivering social value?
Thank you, Melanie, and thank you, very pleased to be here. I mean, just in terms of who we are, I'm sort of CEO and co-founder of The Good Economy, and we're young, and I would say, I'm in a way, many ways new to the real estate sector, but have a background in development finance and impact measurement and management. And, you know, our mission is really how do we enhance the role of private capital and business to play a bigger role in more inclusive and sustainable development. And yes, the work we've done recently, both with the Urban Land Institute and then with Pensions for Purpose Impact Investing, is very relevant. With the Urban Land Institute, the commission really was to help the real estate industry sort of zoom in on the E on the S in ESG, you know, recognizing there's a lot of interest in ESG integration and investments, and certainly, you know, rightly a big focus on the carbon agenda. But the S is more complex. And really, you know, what we said is that there's a tendency to immediately want to measure what are the metrics? How do you measure? And what we said, let's just get back to what social actually means. Social value really means, you know, it's what's in the best interests of society, what's in the best interests of people and places. So it's always context specific how a real estate developer or investor would create social value. When we look at sort of the role of finance, I mean, I think there's sort of two competing trends, really. One is, you know, there's a very globalized financial market and a very sort of digitized financial market. And in a way, that's at odds with really ensuring that, you know, property and real estate development, you know, meets the needs of local communities. Because as people have said, you know, in a way, it's become commodified. You know, we work now with investors in social and affordable housing, and often they talk about assets and yield. And I'm going, you know what? It's homes and people. And from that, you may derive, yes, you know, financial value. And I think at the heart of this and what is now becoming recognized within the investment sector is the need to move towards sort of, you know, integrating what we would call impact considerations, non-financial considerations, into investment decision making, right from the objectives, not just about making financial returns, but what sort of social and environmental difference, you know, do investors want to make? And clearly, you know, through real estate, there's a huge amount, not just in housing, but, you know, town centre regeneration, there's massive need. You know, building on that work, we then did this big project on looking at how do we mobilize more institutional capital to really support the leveling up agenda. We've had, you know, the most entrenched regional equality and frankly social inequality in the whole of Europe for decades in Britain. And what we did is we focused on the local government pension funds because they're naturally place-based, they're local employees. You know, we know from surveys that although most people don't know where their pension money goes, when asked, they would actually like it to be invested for a better world. We also said is that, you know, if you look at the sectors that could drive more sustainable development, they include real estate, you know, infrastructure, clean energy, SME finance, and we looked at the returns of those sectors, mainly in the private markets, but there are listed funds, and they deliver very good, positive, risk-adjusted returns, good portfolio diversification. There's a huge investment opportunity there. Yet when we analysed the holdings of the local government pension funds, less than 1% is in these sectors, and less than 1% is invested in ways that would really drive any form of positive development in the UK. 99% is allocated to global capital markets, with any thought just to big global funds. So what we're sort of saying is, you know, let's just raise awareness of where we're investing our money. There are opportunities to invest across this country, and also to sort of make impact measurement, if you like, a golden thread to really bring this idea of sort of transparency and accountability and partnership working. So there's a real alignment around, you know, delivering on social impact that benefits these places and communities. So, you know, it's a big agenda, but we sort of said, okay, let's make it, you know, 5% would be 16 billion if we just the local government pension funds put money in, all the other pension funds, you know, we could get to, you know, tens of billions just from our own, you know, coffers, if you like. So that's what we're calling for.
Thank you, Sarah. Well, I saw lots of nodding heads on the panel. I'm going to come back to a couple of panel members for their perspective. So I think one of the things you said was, you know, there's a real temptation to rush straight for the metrics. But Adrian, metrics are important, aren't they? I mean, you know, we all grew up being taught what gets measured gets done. So metrics are important, aren't they? And how do we kind of get the right metrics?
Sarah's absolutely right that there are some things that you're just going to have to accept cannot be quantified. You know, can I quantify how happy I am? No, but can I do it on a relative basis? Maybe. And I think that's sort of like what we just have to accept in some regards, is at least in the initial few years when we're on this journey, because it is a journey, and actually, let's be very honest with ourselves, it never ends. It's going to be constant. We're always going to be wanting to improve. But in order to be able to get that capital to move in that direction, we're going to have to start with things that we can evidence the change. And the easiest and most straightforward way for people to get that and get further backing is to be able to quantify that. So just as it happens this morning, I was having a 45-minute detailed conversation about how we can actually go about quantifying and evidencing our ESG metrics for us as a firm, particularly specifically on real estate. And it is not straightforward. It should be, but it is not. And that's really where I think we as an industry really do need to take much more effort and energy being channeled on this. Because if we can start to evidence the impact that we can have on whether it is just the relatively straightforward ones to quantify, like energy efficiency and so forth, investors will have to say, right, for my pound of investment, I've created this delta. So when the next person comes along and says, well, actually, I need this capital to do X, Y, and Z, I've got some of the metrics, but I haven't got all of them, they're more likely to give them the benefit of the doubt. And that's really where I think we as an industry need to understand. Investing, making these decisions, we need to go back to our Victorian pioneers. They did not know it will work. They hoped it would. But then over time, they said, right, the chances are it will. So let's fund these things. Let's continue that. So decision making is an art rather than a science. But as I said, to start that, we need to be a bit more scientific about it.
Jackie, how have you approached this? I mean, do you agree with that?
I am hugely encouraged by what I've heard from the panel, what I've heard from Sarah, what I've heard from Adrian. I mean, you know, if we're going to build back better, the property industry is going to have to be better, you know, and I'm listening to a prescription for us to be better. And I'm about to blow a little bit of smoke in the direction of Peter Freeman, of whom I'm the greatest fan. I have to say I'm the greatest fan ever of Homes England. And there will be a sting in the tail. But just to say, I mean, Homes England also have to be better. Peter's just made a very luminous appointment in the shape of Peter Denton, who is currently chief executive of Hyde Housing Association, to be his new chief executive of his muscular housing agency. Now, Peter Denton made the most incredible speech, the most visionary speech I think I've heard in a long, long time at a Savills conference back in late 2019. I know this because we were so impressed with it that Peter Bill and I quoted this speech in our book. And it was the most amazingly perspicacious moment. It could have been Adrian talking, actually, when he was talking about social value. Now, this is a bloke who came through the city. You know, he was a big banana in Starwood, and then he'd gone into Hyde Housing Association, and now we're lucky enough to get him into Homes England. There's a proper money man we're talking about here, proper city money man. And he was talking about social value, and he was talking about lobbying Her Majesty's Treasury to admit social value to government green book valuations. Now, if he follows through on that, and I know Peter Freeman's in the same place, if the two Peters can follow through on that and hammer this home with Her Majesty's Treasury, well, that will be an incredible advance for us as an industry, who are those of us who are interested in inculcating social value and community interests at the heart of everything we do. Just to finish on Homes England, I mean, you know, Peter is a bit constrained because he's now an agent of the government. I, as I say, couldn't be a bigger fan of Homes England. But they, Peter, you're going to have to ditch your old, money out, homes in model. If we're going to build back better, we're going to have to look at all the stuff that you care about. The money out, homes in model is very one dimensional. We're going to have to look at the understanding of place, the co-location of jobs, all the stuff you get. You do some great work in Homes England on master planning and design codes. And I think that should be way, way to the forefront of all your publicity. But here endeth the bulletin. I am a huge fan. And I have to say, given what Sarah and Adrian are saying about potential for moving forward, I think there's all to play for. And we're pretty good in this industry at looking to the future. We're doing it right now. So let's just hope we can grab these opportunities and run with them.
Peter, right of response.
Well, mostly thank you, Jackie, for those many kind words. I'd like to pick up on some words Sarah said, that the S in ESG is about the best interests of society. And one of the things I've concluded is that there is actually very little conflict between social benefit and commercial benefit. They can actually be made to work really hand in hand and reinforce each other. An example I often use is the fountains in Granary Square at King's Cross. We spent $4 million on the fountains. To our shock, we actually spent about $150,000 a year keeping them up. But we designed them for kids to play in. We designed them so they'd be safe because they're not deep. They'd be fun because they're splashing up and down. They're a big area. You can scooter through them. There's no edge or whatever. And when we were doing that, some people said, you know, you don't want lots of people coming to your square. You know, this is meant to be an office quarter. And we took the view that, you know, the sort of tenants who actually want to be in city centres and want their staff to enjoy life and they want to win in the war for recruiting staff would like kids playing in fountains. So, you know, those fountains have no economic direct value. There's no rent, there's no yield. But we believe that they spill value onto all the buildings around. And then picking up another thing that Sarah said, don't begin with sort of rents and yields. I begin with sort of homes and people. I think for me, the rents and the yield combine as a capital value that needs to exceed construction cost by some way. And it needs to exceed construction cost by some way. Otherwise, you can only construct with government funding. And that's always in short supply. And it's often short term. You know, it's given under one programme, under one announcement. So moving areas to a point where the combination of rents and yields starts getting sort of way beyond 200 to 400 or 500 is the point when you can start constructing lots of buildings or refurbishing them magnificently and putting in squares and places. And then I come to why I think sort of urban regeneration in a holistic way is so important. in an awful lot of towns now, you're looking at rents of sub £10 for almost any use. You're probably looking at yields at 10%, despite, you know, money in the bank being nothing, because people, the leases are so short term, the buildings are in bad condition, whatever. And the combination of that is maybe £100 a foot. And that cannot bring anybody in to develop a new building. They might, if they're lucky and clever, do a nice refurbishment. But even if they're lucky and clever and brave, if they can only refurbish a single building, there's no cluster effect, nothing to draw people in. So although, you know, there are examples of urban regeneration that really have started because somebody set up a great cake shop or whatever, you know, to really change around a town that is big and has got behind, somebody has to come and do something big and holistic to start it, and then it can happen in a ripple effect.
Thanks, Peter. And Rob, I mean, is that, and I might ask Peter this question as well in a minute, but to give him a break from being the target, is that, you know, how is that going to happen? Is that going to be, you know, you touched on sort of the, whether it is the public sector or it's the private sector that's going to deliver all of this, you know, does the government have to step in and sort of pump prime that kind of magnet effect? Or is it going to be the private sector? How is that going to happen? And where's that drive going to come from, do you think?
So just listening to the speakers, it's always uplifting to hear, but it's a bit motherhood and apple pie, bearing in mind the problems in front of us. So to Sarah's point, which I'll reference in a minute, there's opportunities to invest. I don't think there are, Sarah, actually, in terms of giving elements and the ability to invest. Let me explain what I'm talking about. Basically, right up until the pandemic, and right up, and probably to the GFC, most pension funds looked at their money and put their money into global equities, or they put it into bonds. And the trick of that was the bonds, when things were going up and down in the global equity markets, would give you a steady return. There is no return on bonds anymore. There's no return. And going back to the title, Melanie, which is Why Real Estate is Key for a Brighter Future, it's only key to a brighter future if you can access different sources of capital. And that different sources of capital is the retail investor, because they don't touch real estate at the moment. We have a contracting open-ended fund market. We've seen in the last few weeks, two open-ended funds close. My prediction is there won't be any open-ended funds. And why is that? Because of liquidity. Liquidity. You cannot put your money in and get a return. To the private sector and public sector point, and to Peter, in my and our careers, we have seen the effect of PFI and everything that is associated. There wasn't a fair sharing of risk in that. And indeed, there are a number of funds have built big balance, long income funds, who are taking income strips out of local authorities every time. It's slowing down now, but the fact of the matter is the risk stayed in the public sector. It was de-risk. What is the point I'm trying to make? I believe that some of those 200 towns will only be able to come back if you have the expertise of the private sector delivering opportunities to invest, to allow those to be fractionalized so the community can actually invest in those. You need community investment. And it's fine having Big Brother as a government or Homes England. And I will also blow as much smoke to Homes England. You've just got there. Peter Denton is a fantastic guy. Boy, you've got a lot of bureaucracy to get through in terms of where it's at. You need the private sector to actually deliver. And in these towns, it's not a question of pumping money into the high street and painting the shops. It's actually finding the sectors that are going to generate jobs. And those sectors, life sciences, logistics, central government relocation, these people will actually, once you've got the jobs, you've got the town centres and you've got the public open spaces. So lots of things there, Melanie, in terms of where it's at. But coming back to my transparency point, the beautiful thing about a public company and the way things are going, it has to be transparent on a single asset basis. So you have to look at your carbon. You have to look at your other elements that are associated. ESG governance is for this country is known for its governance. It may cause us all to go to distraction, but we have got a model of governance in this country that actually hits the G. And the S part, I'll finish with flying my land aid. As soon as we can get a calculator that actually can help to measure from a property industry point of view, the discussions that you had this morning are going to be so much better. And it's not just guy battle on a local authority model. It has to actually be worked out.
Thanks, Rob. Jackie, your pen was communicating vigorously with us just then. Do you want to come in?
Well, not for the first time, I have to say. I just love Rob Bold. Look, I've got a question for you. I've got a question for you, and I've got a question for you and probably for Sarah as well, possibly for all four of you. Suppose my company, you know, and whatever else you say about us, we are market disruptors. We're a little bit wacky and a little bit off the wall, but, you know, we have got the skills. We do know about urban regeneration. Suppose we rifle through the 200 towns, found a site on the edge of one of them, which was an investable proposition, married that up with a strategy for regenerating the town centre, working in partnership with the local authority and the government. Right, suppose we did all of that. Who would we go to for funding? Rob Bold, Sarah Forster. Who would we go to?
Your first call is to me.
Great answer.
And I would actually show you the structure to be used, but taking Peter's point on the cost, you have to have the business plan that goes with it to show your return. If you've got that, you've got the makings of a public sector issue. And yes, we will, Peter, need government support.
Sarah, okay, your turn to bid for Jackie's business.
Well, I think I wanted to return to the point I think Peter made about holistic development, and that's one thing we're saying. You know, you need joined up investment across, you know, sectors that are going to drive these places. You know, we're doing a lot with creatives, life sciences, health sciences, which are very regionally based, and so, you know, it's breaking down the silos within even investment firms, you know, private equity, real estate, infrastructure, and across governments. So, you know, to get those multiplier effects and really drive local development, that's needed. But, you know, in terms of where you're going to, I mean, Jackie, we're beginning to see, you know, really big commercial real estate players come to us. And, you know, we're always really skeptical about where they really, but, you know, wanting to develop what they're calling impact propositions, impact funds. And certainly that is happening in social and affordable housing, and hats off to Homes England to sort of seeding some of those funds. But we're beginning to see it in urban regeneration. And you know, literally a month ago, I had the head of a real estate firm, one of the biggest global investment firms, say to me, Sarah, we want to stop investing in shiny buildings and invest in socially useful assets. So I said, well, okay, the only way to know what's socially useful is to ask a community and understand, you know, what form of housing, you know, what office space, what public space do they need? And that, you know, and she said, okay, we have no experience of engaging at that level. You know, we work through aggregators. And I said, okay, well, there's a whole new skill set there that you, and there are people out there who work, you know, in progressive development firms and work well with communities. And, you know, we can introduce you to some. And I think it's creating this ecosystem, you know, of investors, developers, consultants, people with the expertise to make things happen. And I genuinely think, you know, it's a question of will and connecting people. I think the money is there. I think public money, you know, what we heard when we did the place-based impact investing, actually what they wanted from government was rather than lots of programs, you know, with these short-term pots that everybody has to bid for, and was, you know, long-term funding for brownfield remediation, you know, that would just cover those costs. Then there were lots of sites that were uneconomic that could be developed. And, you know, just much more strategic long-term funding that would work alongside private capital and deliver on the sort of levelling up agenda. So, yeah.
Absolutely. Fully agree with Sarah in terms of, you know, anecdotal evidence that she's starting to hear about people wanting to really actually go full throttle toward that impact investing. Because we in the real estate space have the ability to actually demonstrate an impact. So we in the private market space, of which real estate is part, are and will continue to be at the forefront of that. If you're in the listed space where you're investing in other people's companies run by other people, it's an influencing method. Here we have direct control. And that, I think, absolutely is what investors are going to be driving forward. And actually so much so, that's what we're doing. We're launching an impact strategy next year. On that, the challenging question that we've been putting to our investors is, how much are you going to sacrifice in the way of financial performance to realize these other non-financial goals? And for us, what we've been pleasantly surprised about so far, and as I said, this is just purely anecdotal evidence at the moment, is post-COVID, there is starting to be a reorientation in how people are viewing investment opportunities. They've realized that volatility is there and is going to be there for quite some time and rearing its head in the most unlikely places. So they're looking for opportunities where actually it's not so much predictability of performance per se, but the nature of your investment is more likely to be predictable. And I'm prepared to take and accept a lower return in pursuit of that. If I have these other impact goals attached to it, it's even more straightforward for us then to pursue those opportunities. Now, coming back to a point which might have been lost, but wasn't lost to me in terms of Peter's intro, you know, he talked about the diversification risk and so forth. I think this is where we have got a real opportunity. Returns over the next two decades are going to be a lot lower than anyone else who started their pension scheme 20 years ago or 30 years ago. That includes me. I still got a long time to go before I retire, and it looks like I'm going to be here for even longer. So I'm going to be looking for predictability above anything else now, because I'm not going to be making those longer, higher returns. And so if I'm the type of capital ultimately who is supporting all of this, these are the kind of opportunities that you're more likely to be investing in. So coming back to Rob's point, to be able to shift the decision maker from a master allocator to the individual is where you're more likely to hasten that pace of change. And I think with new technology, whether it's the approach that IPSX are pioneering or if it's others, I think there is technology empowering that change. You know, my children will not be going down the routes I go through in terms of investing. They'll be having it on their phone. They'll want to see. They'll want to be able to relate to those projects. And that's why I think that notion about localism permeating so much of our society will permeate into the investment space, will particularly permeate actually in terms of on the regeneration. So who knows? It could be, do you want to be funding your local school? Rather than it being a charitable donation, the school would much rather have a longer term source of financing. I can just imagine parents saying, well, I'll buy a school bond for my local area. What's preventing them from doing that is actually the infrastructure that's required to do that. So if we can bring the cost of that structure down, which is what we've done in most other forms of investment, then I think that's what can actually really start to allow these and facilitate the change that we're all espousing. So I've got noble ambitions. I might see them in my lifetime. I really do hope.
What does that thinking mean for Fidelity International? How do you translate that into a business strategy?
Yeah. So what that means is actually exploring notions like tokenization and actually seeing what is the cost of delivering a fund of whatever shape or form it is at the moment to investors. Can we actually reduce the costs of that, or can we actually speed the delivery of that? And can we as well, more importantly, coming back to what we were talking about before, metrics and evidence, can we give evidence the likelihood of us being able to deliver that? And you know, these forms of delivery force you to do that. It forces you to give a lot more granularity about what you're trying to do at point of decision. So the simple way I like to say it is, at the moment, to buy a building, it takes us, what, 3 months, 4 months? That's really inefficient. Why? Because of the lack of data and the availability of data. That's the only difference between us and the listed market. All of that same process happens in a matter of hours, days, minutes. Why can we not have the same approach for these longer-term investments? Then speed that time that it takes to raise the money means it becomes more efficient money and it's more easy to be deployed in the areas that you need it.
Thank you. Peter, do you want to comment?
Yeah. I'm sort of really picking up on things Adrian was saying. And we were talking about the power and the expense of compound interest. If you look at a kind of regeneration project, to turn an area around, you're pretty lucky if you even do it in 10 years. It's more likely to take 15. But let's say it only took 10 years. And then you say, well, regeneration's risky. There's brownfield and there's land assembly problems and planning problems. I want 15% a year. For 10 years, that's four times your money. So there's almost no project in the world that is going to tolerate four times your money. If you instead say, taking Adrian's point, well, I'm looking for long-term smooth returns, and I know that this encompasses the whole town centre, and I believe in town centres, especially when they're underpinned by people and a mix of new uses and improved landscape and improved schools and improved transport, I'm actually happy to have 5% per annum. You're only sort of getting towards doubling at your end of 10 years at 5% per annum rather than four times. So you're saving a huge amount of demand, whether it's on, if government has to pump prime it on the exchequer. You're making things viable. You're making things long-term. You're making them sustainable. And I think to really change the dial on regeneration, we have to think of long-term money coming in cheap and patient. And
I agree with that, but not through a mega fund, because that has all the instincts of central government getting involved, trying to force regeneration at a time when it's not. You can take all your principles, but if you marry it with the private sector investor as well, then you're cooking on gas.
We're pretty much agreed, Rob, actually. Okay. I'll send you a paper later. I agree. It's certainly not for the government to put up all the money, but I don't think it necessarily works town by town, because if you're trying to float Bootle, it will still be harder than floating Cambridge or Oxford. You've got to mix the towns to tease the investors into the less desired ones and make them desired again.
To be continued.
Webinar and awesome, I think. All right, we've got a question from the floor. Thank you for asking it. And please do, in the last 15 minutes, send your questions in. I'm sure you must have questions for our fantastic panel and for the great discussion. So the question is this. I'm going to come to Sarah first, I think, on this. If real estate is increasingly focused on delivering and demonstrating positive impact for a better society, is there not a responsibility to define more clearly what that better society actually looks like? And to articulate a genuine social vision that all our investments and activities should be focused on achieving? And if so, how does that long-term vision sit with short-term political manifesto? So I'm going to ask each of the panelists about this, actually. But, you know, what I'm taking from that question, rightly or wrongly, is, you know, is it our job as an industry to define good social outcomes, or is it our job more to support the delivery of other people's definition of what social impact and social good social value looks like? Sarah, can I come to you first on that?
Sure. No, it's a good question. Actually, something that we debate at The Good Economy a lot, because to be honest, we actually get very disheartened that this country doesn't have a vision, a vision of what it is we want to be as a country, frankly, belong sort of political manifestos. But we think it's not so hard to articulate a vision. When we launched The Good Economy, we wrote our own sort of position paper and just said, you know, a good economy is an economy that works for everyone. People have good jobs that, you know, bring well-being, that has massive health benefits, good homes. You know, we just had these fundamental things that were about a good economy. And, you know, I suppose globally, the nearest thing to a vision in terms of setting, you know, goals are the sustainable development goals. And those are all around, you know, a world without poverty and you know, also a sustainable planet. So we sort of, if you like, the vision has been articulated in many ways. You know, the UK government signed up to the sustainable development goals. We've had local sustainable development plans for many years. But I think, you now, I suppose it's, you know, I think what we see is we, you know, we call ourselves the Good Economy Partnership because we do think it's a partnership between the private, public and social community sectors to come together around, you know, delivering, you know, on a vision, a shared vision, and recognizing there are different incentives and needs for, you know, return and risk sharing. But it's that alignment and, you know, everybody working to their strengths. And, you know, yeah, I suppose shared interests, you know, fair returns, fair risk sharing. And actually, I think, you know, when we work with private investors who get more engaged in delivering not just financial returns, but impact psychologically for the you know, for the fund management teams, they all come to me and said, oh, Sarah, you know, I studied development when I was at university. It's so nice to be doing something positive. And I'm like, well, yes, it makes everybody feel better. Yeah, and they're still making money. So, you know, yeah. Anyway, I'll stop rambling on.
Jackie, whose job is it to set the vision? Is it our job as an industry or is it our job to respond?
Well, I think Sarah's made a magnificent fist of listing out the generic kind of definition of what good looks like. And, you know, we love that. And, you know, jobs, health, you know, all the stuff is fantastic. But of course, I will maintain till the day that I go that the experts in any place are the people who live there. And I'm kind of become almost kind of cliched and boring with this statement that I make the whole time, but I do genuinely believe it. And I do find that the more I trust the community and the more I work with the community, the better result I get. And this, I think, goes to the heart. Adrian mentioned localism. I think what we're uncovering here is a lot of fraught tensions to do with levelling up. So I watch Rob and Peter gamefully grapple with how you get it funded, and thank God for them is all I can say. So I do believe, and I have to say the harsh truth is, I think it will work in some places and not in others. And I'm sorry, but there it is. I think that is the heart. And if we end up with half of these places regenerated, well, I would say half a loaf is better than no bread. So, you know, I'm not that frightened of that, because I think to get half of the 200 back on their feet and thriving would be a result. But the other tension I think it touches on, and it's a real tension that I feel coming out of Whitehall. As you know, I'm a terrible gossip and I do keep quite close to my ex-civil servant colleagues. I feel this coming out of Whitehall is this tension between those in the levelling up arena who believe that it can be done from Whitehall and those who believe that it can only be done through devolution and localism. Now, I am very firmly in the second camp, but I don't believe that the second camp is winning at the moment.
Thank you. Peter, I don't expect you to confirm or deny any rumours and gossip that Jackie may have heard. But I mean, is that in general a conundrum? You recognise that there is a tension between a desire of government to drive an agenda and set leadership and actually the best place for delivery and ownership, which is quite often...
In another of my hats, I was chair of the Urban Centres Recovery Task Force, or co-chair with Robert Jenrick last autumn, this spring. And there were a stellar group, including Howard Bernstein and Richard Leese and Andy Street and Helen Gordon and Alan from Nimmo and whatever. Everybody was agreed that ultimately the vision has got to come locally. Central government should be helping fund, helping provide mentors, but the vision had to come locally. So I'm not sure there is a struggle on that. Then I suspect is more about the controls on money. And you know, clearly Treasury likes controlling money. And I guess it's what its job is for. And we are very much in debt at the end of COVID. So it's finding the balance. I don't think anybody in government doesn't agree that ideas have to be generated locally and you need local leadership. And it's marrying the two. And to some extent, my ideas on and Rob's ideas on bringing in private sector funding help to marry the two, because you don't have to ask for every penny to come from Treasury.
Rob, just pick that up and build on that point, if you would.
Sarah's comments on, is it 18 or 19 UN development goals? And they are very fine things to set structures out, but they are God is good statements in many ways in terms of where they are. So you'd expect me to say, Melanie, in terms of a practical real estate person, it's actually how you start to measure. And it's picking up briefly Adrian's early comments as to, you know, how do we approach the whole ESG thing? But sticking with S, which is the point of the question. My view is from an industry, and yes, I'm sorry, this is myopic and domestic, but at least that's the area that we're playing in the UK at the moment, but this is global, is that if you can receive a defined model to use for social impact that is adopted by an industry which is not necessarily promoted, even though the inputs to that model are highly subjective, if it is a known user of that, and again, that's the work we're doing at LandAid, then that is hugely beneficial to the industry. Because on the other companies that I sit on, everybody is really struggling with this subject. And there's a lot of sustainability, there's a lot of economic aspects that are out there. But when you come to the S part, and let's face it, it's been around for a while, but it's only over COVID that it's really got the momentum that we're now seeing. How do you measure this? How do you measure this? So picking up on that, Melanie, is very much the sooner we can actually get an industry adopted model on social impact, even if you don't agree with some of the black box inputs, at least that will be a consistency that can be adopted by the industry.
Thanks, Rob. And Adrian, you mentioned right at the start, you know, that actually, you know, we are not world leaders in this, though we like to think of ourselves as world leaders in the UK on many fronts. You know, so where can we look to learn? You know, who's better at this than we are, and what can we learn from them?
The environmental side of things, as we've already talked about, is what most of the globe has been focusing their attention on, and now more latterly on the social aspects as well. Suddenly, parts of Europe. I think Germany is certainly one country to look at quite closely. Just their whole approach. And it is interesting that they don't have that strong sense of central government, federal government in the same way. You know, it is a collection of states. And then within each of those states, there's very strong cities exercising quite a lot of discretion and also ability to raise local taxes to fund those regeneration projects. You know, so what this is highlighting is that it's not something that just the real estate world, once it gets its act together, can then suddenly sort things out. There does need to be a whole bunch of other things that need to come along from that. But I think for me, you know, what this is also showing, though, is there has to be a far greater sense of urgency. Yes, great, we're talking about this, but we know how long it takes to actually make the difference. Is it going to be making a difference to somebody who's born today and is going to be going to a school in 5-10 years' time? Possibly. That's, for me, the biggest concern I've got. All of these things take time. So are we prepared to put perfection to one side and actually move at pace and recognize there are going to be certain mistakes, but those are learning opportunities rather than mistakes per se. We need to move. Let's go for those ones which are the relatively straightforward wins. Let's look at how Peter did it successfully at Brindley Place. Let's look at how they did it at King's Cross and go, where was that? Yes, Rob, you can't do it all with public money, but you do need some public focus, attention, whether it's the land, whether it's something else, and actually use that as being the kernel for that accelerated plan. You've heard me speak about education repeatedly. I was in my local school governor's meeting just yesterday, and the challenges that sector is facing is unbelievable. You know, we're talking about quibbling about trying to find £30,000 to balance a school budget, and they can't. So they're looking at how they can monetize different things. Can you imagine if we can find straightforward opportunities that they need to be able to capitalize? They've got land. How can they use it? Can they create new income sources to provide education benefits? We in the private sector are looking for opportunities. Can we actually almost get outside of our own paths and actually just make this happen? So that's where, for me, I think that sense of urgency, I think we need to really sort of like pay much greater attention to.
Thanks, Adrian. Peter, another question from the floor for you, which I think the kernel is, are we going to see new initiatives from Homes England to support sort of the further development of modern methods of construction, particularly with an eye to the opportunity for enhancing or reducing, rather, environmental impact?
We invest directly in it by backing companies as with loans and shareholdings like Ilka and Urban Splash's house joint venture with the Japanese, who are the world's leading manufacturers of homes. We also, when we sell sites and when we give grants to housing associations, tend to put requirements for a percentage of what they do to use MMC. So I think we're doing everything we can to generally encourage it. We're not a house builder, so we can't directly roll it out ourselves. And I think we also try to be reasonably open or blind as to which of the seven categories of MMC is the most effective or should be used in particular circumstances. But it's very much, you know, one of our responsibilities.
Thank you. Thank you very much for that. I'm afraid we're coming to the end of the hour, which has gone in an absolute flash. I hope our audience has found that a fascinating discussion. I certainly have. And I think we were discussing amongst ourselves as panellists before we went live, you know, how we have material for at least three or four more webinars in this, and I believe I heard all of the panelists say they'd be delighted to come back and do this all again later in the year. So watch out for that. But in the meantime, can I thank everyone for attending, and can I thank my panelists, Adrian, Jackie, Sarah, Rob and Peter, very, very much for their openness, their frank views and the wonderful insights they've given us. Thank you very much to everyone, and good afternoon.